we trust what he says. We're going to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 46b. Acts 10, 34 to 46b. As you're getting that, I want to honor my apostle in his absence. Amen. We honor the Lord for him and his work. He's out doing what he's supposed to do. He's out being an apostle, and we honor the Lord for that, that he is doing the work that the Lord has called him to do. And so I honor his wife, Lady Minister, Lady Tracy Coleman. We honor the Lord for you. And Pastor Adrian, who is here. We honor the Lord for Pastor Adrian as well. And so Acts chapter 10, starting at verse 34, says, "So Peter opened his mouth and said, 'Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are his witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God," somebody say, "but God. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name." While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Yes, amen. You can say amen to the word. You can have your seat. You can have your seat. Pentecost is an amazing day for the believer, right? Today is Pentecost Sunday, and Pentecost marks the day where we first find in Scripture the Holy Spirit poured out as recorded in Acts, right? This is 50 days after Resurrection Sunday, right? And so before Jesus ascended, there was a promise to the disciples of a comforter, a helper, a teacher, right? Luke 24 and 49 records it. It says, "And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Pentecost can be focused on one thing or another, depending on your denomination or even your own personal beliefs. But the Holy Spirit is a gift to the believer. Somebody say amen right there. The Holy Spirit is everything that Jesus said that he would be. We often focus on the gifts and the tongues and the charismatic part of who Holy Spirit is, and that's not wrong. But if you are leaning into the Holy Spirit solely based off of a gift or a feeling, then you have missed it. You have strayed, you are lost, and you have settled. The Holy Spirit came to do much for these mortal bodies. But if we relegate the Holy Spirit to how we feel or what we can gain, we have settled for a form of godliness. And my assignment today is to encourage you. Look at somebody and say, "Don't settle." Don't settle. Tell them again, say, "Don't settle." Don't settle. I'm in Acts chapter 10 today, and I read a very small portion of everything that happens in that chapter. It's a very full chapter. I suggest that you would go. I recommend that you go read it, but Acts in general is a very full book, so read that too. Read the whole Bible. But there's a lot that comes along with it, right? So in order to get the fullness of the key verses that I read, we have to go up just a little, and so I'm going to do that. And so Acts 10 begins with a man named Cornelius. Cornelius is an officer in the Roman army. And so tensions were often high between the Romans and Jews, right? And this is because of harsh dominance by the Roman Empire. And so as a Roman, Cornelius would have likely been exposed to numerous gods and different types of theologies. But the scripture says that Cornelius was a devout man and he was dedicated to God. Acts 2 says Cornelius was a devout man who feared God with all his household, gave alms generously to the people, and prayed to God continually. And this is a reminder to us that our environments, even our lineage, and what we've been brought up in does not have to have control over us. On paper, we would say that Cornelius should believe what the Romans believed, but he was a devout man. And he didn't stay anchored to what his family or his heritage said. He chose something different. The scripture says that Cornelius's whole household feared God. And I know that we're in a day and age where anything goes, but one thing the saints of old knew was, as for me and my house, y'all must have heard it too. We gonna say, if you gonna live in this house, everything in this house is going to church. That's what they used to say. Everything living up in this house is coming with me to church. And if this is done right, this is not about control, it's about connection. This is not about people controlling your life. This is about connecting you to what's going to keep you. And in this day, we're giving people choices, and we're leaving our families at home while we come to worship, and we wonder why things haven't changed just because you haven't brought your household into devotion. All right, I know it's too early. I didn't want to hear all this early, but that's all right. We already shouted. The scripture says that Cornelius was a devout man. That means he was devoted. And that devotion affected his environment. This family can't stay the same because I'm devoted. This job can't stay the same because I'm devoted. This community can't stay the same because I'm devoted. This everything attached to me is different because I'm devoted. Christians absent of devotion are in danger. Write that down. Christians absent of devotion are in danger. You can't do anything unless you are devoted to him. If you are not completely into the faith, not a church, even though that will help you too, if you're not completely into the faith, you are at risk at falling away. You need to be devoted. Tell somebody you need to be devoted. You need to be devoted. So Cornelius was a devoted man. And so the scripture gives this account in Acts 10, 3 through 6 of this vision that he has. And so in this vision, the Lord tells Cornelius to send men away and to go and for those men to go and bring back Peter with them. Right. And so this is scary because Cornelius is a Roman sending for Peter, who was Jewish. These two men did not know each other personally, but they still knew what their history told. So there was tension between these two groups. And so obeying God and sending these men was a risk for Cornelius. It was risky business for him to obey. Trusting and obeying God, even for us, is still risky. Cornelius had to believe that if God was speaking to him, God was also speaking to Peter. And we can't always see what God is doing, but we've got to get to the place where we know that if God is calling us to a thing, then he is handling everything about the situation. I know what you told me. I don't know what you got going on the other side of this, Lord, but because you told me, I'm going to trust that you have everything worked out. And this is good news for you, that God is not calling us to anything outside of his control. God is not calling you to do anything that is not already under his control. It's a risk to do so, but we've got to trust him anyway. Risk is attached to the life of the believer. Risk is Rahab, a lady of the evening, if you will, hiding two spies who had been sent to scout Jericho prior to their attack. Risk is Moses and Aaron repeatedly approaching Pharaoh, demanding him to let the children of Israel go. Risk is Abraham tying his own son to an altar to be sacrificed. Risk is Noah building an ark, not even having seen rain before. Risk is being 33 years old and giving up your life for a bunch of people who may not choose you back. Risk is the life of Jesus. Risk is a part of being a believer. And it's important to note however, that the risk that I mentioned came with instructions. Risk does not mean carelessness. Risk does not mean do whatever you want. Risk does not mean go on a half word. Because we've been doing things and say, Lord, you told me to risk it. I told you to risk with instruction. Risk in the life of the believer means having instruction from God and fiercely obeying no matter the backlash that comes with it. Psalm 118 and 6 says, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? That's what you got to say when you're facing something risky. Romans 8 and 31 says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? I'm going to take every single risk that the Lord lays in my lap and understand that there is nothing on this side of heaven that somebody can do to put me in danger of what he controls. Because he's in control, my risk is safe. Because he's in control, my risk is a guaranteed reward on the other side of it. As believers, we have to be willing to take risks that lead to obedience. Risks lead to obedience. And so Cornelius, he has this vision, and he sends these men to go get Peter. And what Cornelius does not know is that Peter is having an encounter with the Lord as well. In Acts 10, 9 through 16, Peter has a vision as well, sent from the Lord. And it's a very strange vision. Peter sees these things come out like on a sheet of paper. And the Lord instructs him to eat these things that Peter would call unclean. And Peter tells God, I can't eat that because they're unclean. And the Lord tells him, don't call unclean what I've already called clean. And so Peter doesn't really understand the vision after it happens. And so he's actually standing there thinking about it. And as he's thinking, as he's trying to get the answer and the revelation, catch this right here, because some of us are moving. And sometimes if you just wait after the Lord says something, you'll get the answer. As Peter is waiting, the men sent by Cornelius come looking for him. If you just wait, you'll get your answer. I know it's exciting when the Lord speaks and we want to start doing and going, but if you wait, you'll get an answer. You don't have to wonder for long. What type of God would speak to us and make us try to piece things together and figure it out? If you wait, you'll get the answer. We don't want to wait, right? And so as Peter is waiting, as Peter is thinking about it, these men come. And the Spirit says to Peter, behold, three men are looking for you. That's scary. Three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them. Peter does not know these men at all, let alone the fact that they are Gentiles and Roman men, right? And they should be an enemy to Peter. But all Peter had was the word from the Lord to go without hesitation. Hesitation is the enemy of urgency. Hesitation is the enemy of urgency. When I was growing up, and we used to play double dutch, really, not regular rope, but double dutch, people would say, no hesitation, right, when the rope was turning. And that meant you had to jump in as soon as they said go. And if you didn't jump in, you was out, I guess. They didn't like you. You can't play no more, right? But this is the same thing that the Lord is calling for us. No hesitation. When I tell you to jump, when I tell you to go, when I tell you to speak, when I tell you to do, when I tell you to answer, no hesitation. Because the space of hesitation is where doubt, unbelief, and faithlessness creeps in. The space of hesitation is where doubt, unbelief, and faithfulness creeps in. If you hesitate, you have time for all that stuff to creep in. But if you're too busy going, you don't have the space for that. If God told Peter to go without hesitation, there had to be an urgency about what was about to happen. There had to be something pressing. There had to be something brewing. There had to be something big that the Lord was leading Peter to. And so we should treat everything that God has told us to do with urgency. We pray with urgency. We love our neighbor with urgency. We even wait with urgency. And you're probably like, how do you wait with urgency? That doesn't make any sense. But that means when God says to start waiting on something, you wait immediately. You don't say, God, let me get this together, then I'll wait. God, let me break up with him, then I'll wait. God, let me quit the job, and then I'll wait. No, when God says to wait, you wait with urgency. And some of us have been believing that we need to set aside time to wait. Wait when he says wait. You waiting on the wait. Wait right now when he says wait. So tell somebody, say wait. With urgency. No more hesitation. We've got to be a people without hesitation. Hesitation hinders the move of God. Because while you're hesitating, somebody's dying. While you're hesitating, somebody's walked away from the faith. While you're hesitating, your child is not believing. While you're hesitating, your workplace is going up in flames. While you're hesitating, there are things that God wants you to take care of, but you can't because you've stopped. You've halted and said, okay, God, I was going to get to it. But in that time, so many things have happened. We need urgency. If you were dealing with an emergency, you wouldn't wait to call 911 to figure out what's happening. You do that thing first. We got to move with urgency. We got to move with and live with urgency. Not just because if you're in a state of urgency, you don't have to work your way up to it. And this is not to be anxious. Like, oh my God, when's the next thing that God's going to tell me to do? No, you still wait on him. But when he says to do a thing, you do it. We do it. We do it. And so the Lord tells Peter to move without hesitation. These men are here looking for him. And so Peter actually does what the Lord says, right? He's up in this house. He goes downstairs and he says, I'm the one you're looking for. What do you need from me? And so the men say that they've been sent by Cornelius. And so Peter goes with them. He obliges. He goes with them to meet Cornelius. And so Cornelius sees Peter and he begins to worship Peter. And Peter says, Cornelius, get up. Like, I'm just a man. Do not worship me. And Peter was not caught up in the hype about himself. Our job as believers is to always point back to the Father. Do I have anybody that says, I will never believe the hype about myself? I will never drink my own Kool-Aid. I don't care how good I get at this. I don't care if I can preach my socks off, if I can teach these braids out of my head. My whole life will always be dedicated to Jesus. It will always be. It will always be about lifting him up. The Apostle Paul said, I know that no good thing dwells within me. And I know that thing to be oh so very true. I know that there is no good thing within me or without me outside of the Holy Spirit. And if he did not decide to use a wretch like me, I would be completely and utterly lost. And so I take no glory. I take no credit for everything that the Lord has done. It's been his goodness to choose me. It's been his goodness to use me and to keep using me. Even when I choose to do the wrong thing, he still chooses me. Is anybody grateful that the Lord still chooses you? Come on, you don't got to be a preacher. You don't got to be a teacher. You just you. The fact that you're here means that the Lord chose you. The fact that you woke up this morning means that he chose you. The fact that you're in this building means he sees you and he chose you. The songwriter said, and if I gain any praise, if I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. That's the reason why we can do what we do. That's the reason why we know what we know. It's all because of Jesus. I'm not caught up in myself. I'm not caught up in the way I speak, the way I look, the way I dress, the person I married. I'm not caught up in none of that. My whole life is because he's been good. My whole life is because he's been faithful. And I'll forever pour out my praise because he's worthy. Somebody lift up a praise if you know he's worthy. Yeah, it's all about Jesus. It's not about my favorite podcast. It's not about my favorite preacher. It's not about my favorite teacher. It's not about self-care. It's about the fact that Jesus left his throne and cared for my soul and gave his life for me, that I would hold a mic, that I can declare his word, that I know his truth, that I know his revelation. It's all about Jesus. Lest I forget. Lest I forget. Lest I forget Calvary. Lest I forget your love for me. Lest I forget that it's all about you, Jesus. It is always about you. Philippians 4:20 says, to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. He gets the glory. He gets the glory. He gets the glory. He gets the glory. And so Peter tells Cornelius to get up and not to worship him, because he understood his position and he understood his assignment. That's an echo of John that said, I ain't nobody, but there's somebody who's coming, whose sandals I'm not even worthy to tie. And so as believers, we've got to always point people back to Jesus. We've got to point them back to Jesus. And so Peter goes with Cornelius, and he goes into his home, and he finds a room full of Gentiles. Acts 10:48, Peter says to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or visit anyone of another nature. Peter understood that this was not something that they should have been doing. But because of the vision that Peter had, he says, I know I was supposed to come here and speak to you. Peter was acknowledging how much this trip goes against what he thought, even the law, right, in any situation that he would normally be in. And this may not have been Peter's preference, but it was purposed. It's always purpose over preference. It's always purpose over preference. I don't prefer to deny myself. I don't prefer to take up a cross. I don't prefer to love my enemies. But it comes with the believer. It's my purpose. And we've diluted purpose to singing and preaching and prophesying and all of those things. And they're attached to the purpose. But your purpose as a Christian is to die. Your purpose as a believer is to lay down your life. Your purpose as a believer is not to be so grand that you forget that this is all about him. Your purpose is to die. So if you're looking for purpose, welcome. It's time for you to die. That's your purpose. But you die in order to live. And so all those other things, the preaching, the teaching, the singing, the dancing, that's a part of it. But the underlying cause of everything is that I would die to my own will, to my own desire, to my own feelings. The purpose of the believer is to die. Right? And so it's important to note here, right? It's so important to note here that this experience with Cornelius and these Gentiles and being together and being able to come together was after Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit. Peter's ability to answer this uncommon call rested on the fact that he was not doing this alone and he was not without help. We focus on Peter's charismatic ministry, the healing, the signs, the preaching, and those are wonderful, but Peter needed the Holy Spirit to obey God. I'm about to set a lot of y'all free, because the reason why it's so hard to obey is because you're trying to do it on your own. You need the Holy Spirit to obey God. That's why Jesus calls the Holy Spirit the helper, because he helps. Right? John 14:16, Jesus says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. You've been trying to do this on your own. You've been trying to trust God and obey him and do his will on your own, and you do not have to. Tell somebody, we are not without help. Say it strong, we are not without help. And I'll prove to you in scripture, Psalm 121, the whole chapter says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Somebody say, I'm not without help. You've been trying to keep yourself and guard yourself and try not to do this and try not to say that. Let the Holy Spirit do his job. He does that for you. You're not without help. You are not without help. You're not here without the help on the accessibility of the Holy Spirit. Some of us are without help because we haven't granted him access. But as soon as you grant him access, you'll get the help. He's a helper in the time of trouble. He is my helper in the time of trouble. He's my helper in the time of trouble. When I can't see my way, he's my helper. When I'm falling apart, he's my keeper. When I need some protection, he shades me. He keeps me on my right, on my left, in the back, in the front. He's my keeper. He's my sustainer. He's the lifter of my head. The Holy Spirit is everything that I've ever needed him to be. And if he couldn't be that, I didn't need it. He's been everything. He's been better than life to me. He's been a keeper. He's been a sustainer. He's been a mind regulator. He's rid of my anxiety. He's rid of me of depression. He's been everything. He's been everything. And so I don't have to look to a person. I don't have to look to a system. I don't gotta look to a president, but I will lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. And this I know, this I've experienced, this I've tasted, that all of my help, all of my help, all of my help, it comes from the Lord. And if you know you've been helped, if you know you've been kept, why don't you lift up something to your helper? You've been my help. You've been my help. You've been that to me. You've been that to me. You've been my help, Lord. And I give you all the glory. And so if you are without help, grant him access. If you're without help, open your heart. If you're without help, call on him. He will not forsake those who call on his name. You don't have to live without help. You can't live without this help. This world thinks they're living, but they're actively dying. They think we're ridiculous when they're the ridiculous ones. They need the help of the Holy Spirit. And so why would we have experience with him Sunday after Sunday, but not have real help? He can be your help. This is the help that we've got access to, that he helps us. The scripture says he doesn't even sleep because he's taking care of me. That's what that means. When it says he won't slumber, that means he don't need no time off from this. He's not switching shifts with nobody. He didn't call nobody into cover when he got tired, but he said, this is around the clock care. Oh, come on. You know, people in the hospital, when they need around the clock care, so they got to switch shifts so somebody can come in, they tag somebody in. The Lord does not need that. His nature is to care for me around the clock. His nature is to grant me peace around the clock. His nature is to grant me mercy around the clock. This is his nature. There's never been a time in my life where I've been without help. There's never been a moment in my life where I've been without help. There's never been a time in my journey where I didn't have help. That's a lie from the enemy. I've always been kept by him. I've always been helped by him. I've always been upheld by him. He's been my help. He's been my help. He's been my help. Let me get back into this. He's been my help, because I could stay there. He's been my help. And so you've got help today. He's not just my help. He's your help too. He wants to be your help. He wants to be your help, right? And so Peter has the Holy Spirit. And so Peter needed the Holy Spirit for this task. Peter needed the Holy Spirit to be able to be in a room full of Gentiles, a room full of Romans, and still be safe. He needed the Holy Spirit to be able to stay with these people once he found out who they were. Because being with these Gentiles was unsafe and it was unlawful. And so I want to bring you back into who Peter was. This is the same Peter who denied Jesus because of how unsafe it was to be associated with him. And so Peter goes from somebody who runs from something being unsafe, who knowingly stays into something that is unsafe. Right? Peter is in a risky, dangerous situation and can navigate it well because he has the help of the Holy Spirit. This is why we can't just settle for the feeling of the Holy Spirit. We desperately need the filling of the Holy Spirit. Because when the Holy Spirit comes, I have the ability to have hard conversations. When the Holy Spirit comes, I have the ability to do hard things. I don't just shout. I don't just cry. I don't just feel different. I am different. And that difference is measurable. Peter was different from when he last denied Jesus to this moment. We see that he is a different person. Transformation in private is ridiculous. It's never been a thing for the believer. Process can be private, but transformation is public. This is a very public declaration of Peter's transformation. If transformation was not public, the Bible wouldn't tell us stories of Moses, who murdered somebody and ran and then was brave enough to stand in Pharaoh's face. If transformation was private, we wouldn't have stories of David, who did terrible things but wrote the most beautiful psalms in the Bible. If transformation was private, we wouldn't have the story of Paul with such great detail. Transformation is public for the believer. And I know that's scary. Trust me, I know that's scary. But it's a testimony of the goodness of God. The information that we have about these biblical figures that we talk about so much, it's not just information or for inspiration. It was for transformation. It's not just so that we can know about it or say, oh my gosh, that was really amazing that they transformed. It was for us to do the same. It was a model. It was a blueprint. You're supposed to transform too. You're supposed to be different too. Holy Spirit comes and there is evidence. There is evidence of the fact that we are transformed and we are not the same people that we used to be. There is evidence. Tell somebody there's evidence. Right? And so Peter has the Holy Spirit. This is a fact, right? But in Scripture, Peter has many experiences with the Holy Spirit. Peter was there in John 20 and 22 when Jesus breathed on the disciples and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Peter was there in Acts 2 and 4 in the upper room, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. Acts 4 and 8 recounts Peter being filled with the Holy Spirit. These instances were not a one-time event. It was something that God wanted to continue to do in Peter's life. As Apostle always says, there's one baptism, but there's many refillings. There's one baptism, but there's many refillings. Don't just settle for one filling. Be refilled. Don't just settle for one filling, be refilled. I can't fill my car up with gas, drive it around, and expect it to never need to be full again. It needs to be refilled. With use, it needs to be refilled. With mileage, it needs to be refilled. When it's going somewhere, it needs to be refilled. And so if you're a believer and you've been doing stuff, you've been going places, you need to be refilled. This is not to say that the Holy Spirit wears off, hear me clearly, or is not powerful enough to last. But because of our choices and our sinful nature, we often diminish the work of the Spirit in our lives. So the Holy Spirit is not wearing off day by day as you're with him. But because we are people, we're in this body, we're in this flesh, we need to be refilled. 1 Thessalonians 5:19, Paul tells the Thessalonians, that scripture that we learned, quench not the Spirit, right? In other words, he was telling them, don't stop the work of the Spirit, which means it can be done. So being refilled with the Spirit gives the Holy Spirit continued access to lead and to guide us away from what we once gave into. I'm going to say it again. Being refilled with the Spirit gives the Spirit access to lead and guide us away from what we once gave into. And so the refilling is not so that you can go back and do the same thing. The refilling is so that you can go back and choose different. Because the same temptation is waiting for you after you leave this building. The same person still wants to call you, that same habit. You didn't just leave it at home. You're going to confront that thing again. But here's what the Holy Spirit does. He lives in you, leads you away from it so that you don't fall into temptation. And we've even got the idea of sin and temptation mixed up. Temptation is not a bad thing. Sin is. Remember the hymn that said, yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. Once you give in to temptation, you have sin. But if you can stand against temptation with the Holy Spirit, then you can see that the Holy Spirit is active in your life. We get refilled because we need him. We get refilled because we need him. And so being baptized with the Holy Spirit is a wonderful thing, but you're going to always need to be refilled. You're going to always need to be refilled. And so Peter, already filled with the Holy Spirit, he begins to speak to these Gentiles. This is a good part. I hope you're still with me. This is a really, really good part. He begins to speak to these Gentiles, and one of the key points, it's the opening point of his message to them, is this revelation of how God is not partial with the gospel. Peter formerly believed that the message was only for the Jews, which is built on the foundational truth that the message first came to the Jews, which was true, right? But here, Peter is openly confessing that a divide existed because of incorrect thinking and mistreatment. Peter, on both sides, he's acknowledging the fact that Jew and Gentile, both parties, contributed to the divide that existed. And I know that people have made this popular on social media, but this is real. The Holy Spirit does not just make you charismatic. He makes you apologize. When Peter confronted the Gentiles, he said, I was wrong. Now I know that God is not partial with this gospel. We have been partial. We have done this wrong. And so before Peter could preach to them, he had to apologize to them. The Holy Spirit does not just make us charismatic. He makes us aware. He makes us aware of when we mistreat people. He makes us aware of when we've contributed to wrongdoing, because everything wasn't everybody else. Sometimes it was us too. He makes you aware of when you're unloving, unkind, unjust. And anybody, I'm going to say this with my chest, anybody who claims that they have the Holy Spirit but cannot become aware of their faults, either by revelation or conversation, does not have the Holy Spirit. I'm going to say it again. Anybody who claims that they have the Spirit but cannot become aware of their faults, either by revelation from God or conversation with believers, does not have the Holy Spirit. Period. And it's tight, but it's right. If we can't acknowledge the things that we've done wrong in certain spaces, in certain groups, in certain ways we've showed up to other people, we are quenching the Spirit. And you need to submit again. The first thing that came out of Peter's mouth was not a rebuke to these Gentiles. The first thing that came out of Peter's mouth was not tongues. The first thing that came out of Peter's mouth was confession. He freely admitted his erroneous way of thinking. I was wrong about this, actually. I got this wrong, actually. And this is the good part right here, because I'm not just going to put it on Peter, right? Because this was an error on both the Jews and the Gentiles / Romans part. What blesses me about this part is that the Gentiles stayed. They could have walked away in offense. They could have said, this is what you thought about us? I'm out of here. Because remember, Peter has just had this vision about 4 days ago. Three is four, a day and a half ago. I forget. So this wasn't a long time that he had changed his mind. This is a few hours. And so they could have been angry and said, you thought this about us 2 days ago? I'm out of here. I don't want to hear anything you have to say. But when the Holy Spirit comes, he brings healing in real time. When the Holy Spirit comes, he brings healing in real time. So I'm not the same person I was last year. Don't treat me like that. I'm not the same person I was last night. Don't treat me like that. I'm not the same person I was 15 minutes ago. Don't treat me like that. The Holy Spirit changed me. The Holy Spirit changed me. And so this was not just godly on Peter's part, but the Gentiles had the ability to wipe the slate clean and receive Peter as new. And that was a work of the Holy Spirit. They didn't even have the Holy Spirit yet, but they were already operating in a level of forgiveness that most of us believers cannot. What you said to me at the meeting last week, I'm done with you. What you said in the group chat, I'm done with you. But our ability to wipe the slate clean and receive people as new is a work of the Holy Spirit. And we've got to at least possess the desire to extend that kind of mercy to people. You're not always going to get it right. We're not always going to do it right. But you've got to at least possess the desire to want to be merciful. Because we've been extended great mercy. I'm talking about a lot of hymns today, but if you know me, this is what I do all the time. The hymn says, mercy there was great, and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. We've been recipients of great mercy. And so we've got to pardon people because we've been pardoned. And the way a pardon works is that you're not guilty. You did the things. You hurt my feelings. You said something wrong to me. This hurt me. This was wrong. But I'm not going to punish you. I'm going to act like you never did it. That's a pardon. The Gentiles pardoned Peter. And they stayed and they listened to this message. They listened to this gospel. They both wiped the slate clean on each other. And we want people to be the bigger person, whatever that means as Christians. We want people to be the bigger person and apologize to us. But we both got to wipe the slate clean because guess what? Technically, Peter was the only person walking in this situation with the Holy Ghost. Peter was the only person that had the responsibility and the heaviness and the weight of the Holy Spirit. And so with that, he was charged to be the bigger person. He was charged to be the Christian. And we want people that don't even know him to be better than us. You are the Christian. Show up like a Christian. Pardon like a Christian. Extend mercy like a Christian. If you got the Holy Ghost, you got the power within you to pardon people. Pardon me. Pardon somebody else because you've been pardoned. Peter walks into this situation, the only one full of the Holy Ghost after numerous experiences, not just filled, but refillings. And he's able to walk in and say, yo, I was absolutely wrong about this. And from that space, they were able to receive the gospel. Peter preaches the gospel to these Gentiles, and the message is so good, it's so real, it's so life-changing, that these Gentiles are filled with the Holy Spirit. An openness to the gospel will result in the filling of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to set you free again. An openness to the gospel, not a preacher, not a thought, not a theology, to the gospel will result in a filling of the Holy Spirit. You don't have to force it. You don't have to pray like somebody else. You don't have to tarry for it. Uh-oh. If you are open, there will be a response. If you are open, there will be a response. There will be a filling. There will be results of your openness. We celebrate Pentecost so much, but this is what Pentecost is all about. The believers were in one place, on one accord, open to what they were waiting for. And what's the result? They are filled. Openness is the prerequisite for a filling. Not knowing everything, not doing everything right. Openness is the prerequisite for being filled by the Holy Spirit. You can't fill something that's closed. If I got a water bottle and I got a cap on, I'm trying to pour something in, it's not going to get in there. You got to take the cap off. Tell somebody, take the cap off. Get loose. Get open. Break open if you got to. Whatever you got to do, but you have to be open. For the Gentiles, it wasn't about Peter's preaching style. All right, because y'all got favorite preachers. And y'all call me y'all favorite teacher, and I love it. But it wasn't about a style. It wasn't about exegeting a text, even though he did. It wasn't about all skill. It wasn't about all of those things. It wasn't even about the history that existed. And they didn't go to Peter because he was the prophet that was coming to town. They weren't looking for a word. They just came looking and open. It was about the gospel. This was about the gospel. And I know we're looking, especially right now, for strategy, for answers, for comfort and the like, but the gospel is the answer. If the gospel is preached, you will see salvation for the lost. If the gospel is preached, hear me when I say this, we'll see true repentance for those who don't know him. If the gospel is preached, lives are changed for real. It's about Jesus and it's about this gospel. And we've got to get back to the gospel. And for some of you, this is not a point of condemnation. This is a conviction. You can't really articulate the gospel. But that's a point where you ask Holy Spirit, the teacher, to teach you. And that's when you come into the church to be taught. We've got to get back to the gospel. 2 Corinthians 4 and 3 says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. I'm going to say it again because I feel this thing. If our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. And we've got this gospel. We know it. But there are people who do not know Jesus. And that's why this world is upside down. We've got to get to the point where we want the Holy Spirit not to huck and buck, but to preach the gospel with clarity and effectiveness. And I pray that the conviction of the Holy Spirit is in this room, that you don't want to grab a mic before you want to talk to somebody at your job. That's before you grab a mic, you don't want to talk to, you want to evangelize on your, at your workplace, in your family. This is about the gospel, spreading of the gospel. And public platforms are wonderful. We can do amazing things for people who can't come here. But if you don't know the gospel and can't articulate it to those that are lost, the gospel is hid. And relying on preachers and pastors just won't do it. Everybody has the ability to spread this gospel. You don't have to be in it for a year to say, now I can spread the gospel. As soon as you in, start talking about it. I went to an event for something on Saturday, a job that I just got. I don't know anything about this company. I don't know a thing. But guess what? As soon as I got there, they treated me like an employee. So they said, talk to these people. Learn as you go. You're not going to get it right. You're not going to know everything. But since you're in this, you've been equipped to do it. You've been given the authority. And so the same with us. As soon as you got into this faith, you had the ability and the authority to spread this gospel. It's about the gospel. So at the end of this, the Gentiles end up being filled and speaking in tongues. So not only did they receive the Holy Spirit, but they also received the gift of tongues. So the tongues were a wonderful display of the encounter, but the Holy Spirit was supreme over the tongues. And this is not an attack on tongues. I speak in tongues. This is not an attack on gifts of the Spirit. I love the gifts of the Spirit. The Bible says that the gifts of the Spirit are given to the body for the edifying and the upbuilding of the church. But we've settled for gifts when we can really have an abundant, devoted life. We've settled for being charismatic when we can be changed. We've settled for being super gifted, but we can't be super transparent and talk to people. And so here's the thing, when your gift is not in use, your identity remains because of the Holy Spirit. A lot of us have tied our identity to our gifts. And so when we're not using them, we don't know who we are. But if you have the Holy Spirit, you'll know exactly who you are. Whether you're singing or not, whether you're prophesying or not, whether you're teaching or not, whether you're ushering or not. If you have the Holy Spirit, you'll always know who you are. And this is where the imbalance comes. This is where the attack comes. Because I've learned that the area that you are gifted in the most can be the area that you're most troubled in. And so that's why you need the Holy Spirit to navigate that trouble. The enemy doesn't attack me in any more area than the way I speak, the way I think, the way I relate to people. And that's because it's attached to my gift. I navigate that not by teaching more, but by relying on the Holy Spirit that gave me the gift to begin with. You want to navigate torment? Get the Holy Spirit. You want to navigate an identity crisis? Get the Holy Spirit. You want to navigate not knowing who you are if you're not being seen? Get the Holy Spirit. My gift doesn't lead me out of torment. I can't teach my way out of torment. You can't sing or prophesy your way out of torment. You need the Holy Spirit for that. Can't do none of it. My gifts don't lead me from temptation. You gifted and tempted, just like everybody else. The Holy Spirit does that. The Holy Spirit does that for his people. Submission, openness to him and submission to him is what does that for us. And so I saw this video very recently, and I'm coming to a close. If the media team can help me out. I saw this video recently of this plant that was growing, right? And what's it called? Sped up. I forget what it's called. My words are not coming to me. Time lapse. That was the word, right? And so this plant is growing. The leaves are growing. And then the flower grows. And so in my mind, I would say, oh, it's fully grown. There's a flower there. But then the flower dies and the fruit comes. And so some of us are settling for flowers. We're settling for leaves. We're settling for growth even. And we get to a flower and it's beautiful. I'm done. But the fruit didn't come yet. The only way that the bell pepper can come is after the flower dies. If you look at this video, the flower grows nicely and then it shrivels up and dies. And then the bell pepper grows. And hear me today when I say this to you. I say this as a preacher and teacher of the gospel, that I don't want you to settle for flowers. I want you to grow fruit. I want you to mature. I want you to love people. It's amazing to be gifted and to be talented and to speak in tongues. And Pentecost is a wonderful experience. It's iconic. It's legendary. It marks a day for believers. But if we terminate on gifts, if we terminate on tongues, and we never grow the fruit that Lady Tracy was speaking about this morning, we are of no effect to this dying world. The world is full of flowers. The world is full of leaves. The world is full of growth. But where is the fruit? Where are the people of God? And I'm not asking you, I'm not telling you to be perfect, even though you should be perfect, as in mature, as in submitted to the process. But what you need to be is submitted to the Holy Spirit so that you can grow fruit. Everybody's standing. Peter will go down in history for performing the miracles, establishing the early church, traveling, spreading the gospel, all under the power of the Holy Spirit. And this is important. But without the transforming power of the Holy Spirit, he would not have been able to preach a message to the Gentiles who were not like him, who did not believe. He needed the Holy Spirit to preach and to serve those who once hated him, and even the ones he once hated. Those things without the Holy Spirit would prove to be flowers and not fruit. Pentecost is a marked day for us. It's a day to celebrate the fact that we have access to the Holy Spirit. And on this wonderful day, I want you to lift your hands. Don't just settle for the experience. Don't just settle for the feeling. Be changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Be changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit. You don't have to get everything right. You don't have to be in a certain place in your life. Today you can be changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so every open vessel, just begin to open up your mouth and ask the Lord to fill you. Come on. Every open vessel, if you're not open, then you don't have to pray. But every open vessel, and even those that are not open, I pray that the revelation of Jesus Christ would hit you where you are, and that you would become open to his move, that you would become open to his pulling, that you would become open to his pressing. Even in the online audience, if you're at home, be open to the refilling or the filling of the Holy Spirit. Be open. The worship team is about to sing, but even as they continue to sing, don't just get caught up in a song. Be caught up in the fact that you can be transformed. In Jesus' name.
Christ is my friend. Father. everything.